Everything Old is New Again, America's entertainment pop culture talk show.
It may well possess a rudimentary intelligence.
I'm trying to think, but nothing happens.
Felt a great disturbance in the force.
Hello, I'm Mr. Red.
Come on, Mark, like a job for me.
Where's the goodies?
Leave the gun. Take the cannoli.
I bet you wouldn't have done anything like this if Mom and Dad were here.
You filthy criminal.
Excuse me while I whip this out.
Go ahead. Make my day.
Here are your hosts, Douglas Viviani and David Cohen.
In a past life, he was himself. If opportunity knocks and he's not home, opportunity waits. He is the life of parties he has never attended. Sharks have a week dedicated to him. He is the most interesting man in the world.
Welcome to Everything Old is New Again. Douglas Viviani here with, the rather curious David Cohen. And that introduction, who is the most interesting man in the world? If you're listening to Everything Old is New Again over this last 7 years, you know that Peter Weller, who has been in more than 70 films and all kinds of TV series, and, of course, RoboCop, you know, from those first two movies, and he's into all the way through to Adventures of Buckaroo Banzai in the Eighth Dimension, to Star Trek into Darkness, and television, and hosting Engineering and Empire. He's been in 24, and a great episode of Fringe and Sons of Anarchy. It goes on and on now, directing all kinds of episodes in Hawaii of Hawaii 5-0 and Magnum PI and more. He's, of course, a doctor himself, a PhD at UCLA in Italian Renaissance art history. And so we are privileged and happy to, again, share the stage, so to speak, with the one and only most interesting man in the world to us, Dr. Peter Weller. Thank you, and welcome to Everything Old's New Again.
Hey, thank you, David. Thank you, Doug. Pleasure to be here again. You guys are also intelligent. Listen, Shai McBride, one of the great actors and fun guys ever from Chicago, does this goof on me being the most interesting man in the world. And then when I hear you guys do it, I think, like, okay, I'm thinking of people in my ilk who have fascinated me, and I just spent a weekend with one of them. At a Comic-Con in New Jersey, the wonderful Christopher Lloyd. Chris Lloyd may be one of the most interesting men in the world, or people in the world. And I'm trying to think of somebody else, maybe Richard Dreyfuss. I'd sit in a room with those two guys, boy, would the, and maybe James Woods, as crazy and nutty and wonderful as he is. I've known him since he's 18. I've known these guys for so long. You know, Chris can either be like silent and listen to everybody for 40 minutes and not say a word, and then probably repeat verbatim, because he's like almost a genius like you, what everybody has said, or he's like Doc, you know, in Back to the Future. He's one of the two. You either get one or you get the other. So I always compliment Shai, or you guys, for saying that. I appreciate it because, as Leonardo da Vinci said to a Francois Le Premier, who gave this place to live before it passed away, you know, what's the secret to your life? And he said, curiosity. And that's all it takes to be interesting, is being curious. And my mother always said to me, God bless her, you know, you're never bored. Don't be bored. Bored's just a function of anger. Yeah, you wouldn't be bored if you were standing on your head in a guardhouse. But she always said that. I think. Why does she, what does that metaphor mean, standing on my head in a guardhouse? So anyway, interest is just a function of curiosity, and I hope I remain curious forever.
Well, that's part of it, is being curious, but also then seeking the answers and remembering the answers. You've got to have that to log into the brain. And what I love about that conversation and introduction is that, of course, David and I's sort of sensibilities rise a little bit when, like, what do you say when people are talking behind your back, you get an itchy palm or whatever? Because I know that you're talking about Everything Old is New Again left and right to your buddies and spreading the word. So we're
sure. So, I definitely am. But, you know, speaking of Everything Old is New Again and being curious, though, my oldest friend and one of my oldest friends, closest friends, and my godfather of my child, I might have mentioned it before, is an antiquarian book dealer, one of the top four in the world, top three or four, named Mark Heim of Bibliocopus. And, you know, he sells to everybody. He's the, you know, British Museum, Library of Congress, Yale, you know, Gates, Steve Lusso, whatever. But I meet with him about twice a week, and it's just the conversation goes into just the most amazing areas, like, because he's always learning new things, and his catalog comes out, and all of a sudden I found out about this guy, Charles Worth. You ever know who Charles Worth is? Charles Worth is a guy who was in London in the 1800s, late 1800s, and he wanted to take the bones and all of the structure out of women's dresses such that they could. He also wanted to, like, you know, if you were wealthy and you were female, you had to have a seamstress come and fit you and make dresses for you. There were no stores where you bought dresses. So he couldn't get arrested in London. He goes to Paris. He comes up with this idea of women coming to him so he can fit them, and taking out all of the superstructure of dresses such that women could take afternoon walks like men can. Because some of those dresses, if you got to see, like at the Victorian age, they couldn't go through a door. They couldn't walk through a door with those things. So he's lowering the bustier, and he's taking the bones out of the thing and the structure out of the thing, such that the dress is loose. Cannot get arrested in London. Goes to Paris. Not only comes up with that, he comes up with the idea of women coming to him and fitting them. Then he comes up with the idea of models, modeling ideas. And then he comes up with Fashion Magazine. And he is the guy that kicks off what we consider haute couture, an Englishman in Paris. And when you see these Gustave Caillebotte or these impressionist paintings of women and men taking walks through Paris, this wasn't done in the early 1800s. I mean, this is astounding to think that a couple didn't really take a walk in the afternoon because the clothes, I mean, just the entertainment world, because the clothes were so impossible that they prohibited any sort of functionality of enjoyment. And once this guy, Charles Worth, got into it, then Lanvin got into it, and then everybody got into this thing. But I just found this out, like, well, a couple of weeks ago. Google the guy, amazing. You know, like, where did all this begin? And then this guy that really changed it again, because once again, a men's clothing and women's clothing got pretty stiff in a postmodern, post-World War II particular time. Everything is old is new again. You know, you go right back into these, like, men had to wear suits that were very blockish if they were going to wear suits at all. And the guy that I think that really transformed it again, where we could walk around with jeans and a sport coat. The guy that took the lining out of the sport coat, boxed the shoulders, lowered the buttons so that skinny guys, heavy guys, everybody could wear a jacket, was Armani. And Giorgio Armani transformed it again, single-handedly. So, you know, I sit with Mark Heim, and I, you know, we're talking about, like, Machiavellian politics to, like, women's fashion. And this is everything old is new again. Yeah. I would rather talk about everything old is new again than basically, you know, current politics, so.
Well, along those lines, you know, we all learn, as we talked about earlier, being curious and learn through, you know, trying to answer the questions and be open to what's out there. You're directing now, and at some point you had to learn, I would say, to direct. And we're focused a little bit more recently. We're thinking of doing a show on, or a number of shows on directors and movie directors, more specifically, I guess, in this particular idea. And my thought is, from your perspective, are there directors that you've learned, whether it be vicariously or personally, the skill, or did you learn it yourself by, you know, acting and taking your own sensibilities to directing? And I guess a better question is, what directors do you admire, whether you've worked with them or not?
Let's go back. The short order, the short form is a guy named Robert Yanni, who was also a major political guy, But he was the sort of the P.T. Barnum, the boy genius for Walt Disney, and one of the guys that started the Mickey Mouse Club, and I don't know. And he put me on the stage when he was, my father was in the Army, a helicopter pilot. Put me on the stage when I was 10. Robert Yanni was drafted, became part of civil service, met my mother. And Robert Yanni went on to revamp our Radio City Music Hall, to conceive of Ronald Reagan's entire gubernatorial run, to redo the Rose Bowl parade, to, you know, what the Orlando Disney East was one of, he was conceptual with that. But he puts me on the stage when I'm 10. And I like performing, you know, but I really want to play the trumpet.
Wow, unfortunately, time flies here. We will be back right after this on Everything Old Is New Again, to continue with Peter Weller.
You're listening to Everything Old Is New Again, America's entertainment pop culture talk show with Douglas Viviani and David Cohen.
All right, we're back here on Everything Old Is New Again with Dr. Peter Weller, talking all things life and interests and motivations. And we were talking about you trying to be like Miles Davis.
But then I realized I'm not going to be Miles Davis. I'm in North Texas and Vietnam is going on. I better find something, because it's like Whiplash. If you saw that film, that's like my story in a way. Somebody said, hey, there's a story about you in music school. I said, there's no story. It's going to talk about how tough it is in a jazz music school, a contemporary music school. Then I saw Whiplash. And it was like a meat hook in my heart, that movie, because that's what it was for me. You know, competition was so horrendous. And attitudes where, you know, jazzers are great guys, but they're like mercenary. And I just said, okay, what am I going to do? Okay, I'm going to go back to performing. And then I realized I was going to act. I had a transformation. I was sitting in an acting class. I was majoring in English and theater. I was not majoring in music anymore, North Texas State, which is one of the great, great music schools, and maybe the first contemporary music school ever, under Leon Breeden. And all those guys went on to play in The Tonight Show and play with Saturday Night Live, Lou Marini, all these amazing guys. I said, okay, I'm going to be an actor. So I'm going to be. Okay, when I became an actor, let me give you a context here. When I'm growing up, or westerns. My favorite movie of all time is a John Sturges movie called O.K. Corral, written by Leon Uris, his only original screenplay. And yeah, it fudges the truth a lot, but it's Burt Lancaster and Kirk Douglas and Dennis Hopper became a buddy, and those are my things. But at the same time, the movies that penetrate me are the movies that penetrate most people. They're not big action movies, although those are entertaining and everything. The small personal movie, about how life changes. I see Tennessee Williams' Street Cred and Desire, I think, when I was six, and it still rang with me, because my mother had to take me over. She went to see it. But movies about dilemmas, personal dilemmas. Now, I'm going to give you guys like a context for this, because I'm teaching a class on a webinar. A guy named Rocky Ruggiero has one of the largest Italian art Renaissance art webinars anywhere. And me and a documentary kid named Jordan Letty are teaching a class every Thursday, 3:00 Pacific time, on Italian neorealism. And here are the movies that stem from the, here's what stem, speaking of everything as old as new again, movies per se before World War II in Italy were essentially, you know, historical romance or whodunits or, you know, The Thin Man or, you know, and not to say they weren't great movies. But then you got Italy. It's immensely immersed in movies. But then you got Italy all of a sudden, it's fascist. It's not giving up anybody to Shoah. It's not giving up anybody to the Germans. It's one thing with Mussolini. If you were somebody who didn't like, he would exile you to the south of Italy, which is the great story, Christ stopped at Eboli. But when the Germans come in, it's a different game. And when the Nazis from Germany come in, then people get deported, people start to lose, people go to death camps, and this place turns into hell. Rome becomes this open city. There's an amazing movie called Roma, Open City by Roberto Rossellini that started the career of Anna Magnani. A guy goes and gets a camera when the Germans are leaving and the Allies are coming in. Cinecittà, one of the biggest movie studios in the world, has bombed out. Goes against the camera, writes a movie about the dilemma of finding yourself, love, dignity, survival in a city where it's been destroyed by one side and is now, it's not been destroyed, but it has morally and ethically been destroyed by, you know, 15, 16 years of fascism under Mussolini and also now the Germans, not to chastise the Germans, the Wehrmacht, for instance. And now the Allies are coming in from the South and who knows what they're going to do. And this guy writes this film and makes it during the war, at the end of the war. This is insane. This is like Battle of Algiers. You know, Pontecorvo went into Algeria 2 years after that thing, or I Am Cuba. There's probably three great docudramas ever whereby somebody was shooting in the end zone of horror, telling a story about the very horror that had just happened. But Mussolini is talking about it now while it's happening. So in any case, those movies, what happens with Italy is Italy starts to make movies about the personal journey because they are socioeconomically destroyed and they want to know, how do we live and how do we get rich? You know, how do we survive? How do you find love? How do you find your way? How do you find your place in the sun? My God, what are we going to do? The movies that come out of Italy from the time of the 40s all the way up to the 70s, let's say Garden of the Pizzicantini's, is what I'm now giving this webinar in. Those are the movies that gave America a lease on life again. Because while Hollywood was still obsessed with glitz, right, Italy was obsessed with journey. And there's 15, 16 movies. And so I got to work, you know, I mean, I'm coming up. And I see, when I was a kid, I saw L'Avventura. I saw L'Avventura, Antonioni's L'Avventura. And then I saw La Dolce Vita. And I saw La Dolce Vita and L'Avventura. I said, I had no idea what they were about. I mean, I'm a teenager and I watched, I had no idea. But they just knocked me down. And so I just gave a class, Jordan Letty and I, a documentary filmmaker, gave this class on L'Avventura last week. Those are the movies that got me. So subsequently, the American movies are all in the 50s and 60s are a fallout of that. I'm looking at the movies of Sidney Lumet. I see, speaking of Anna Magnani, I see The Fugitive Kind, which is based on Tennessee Williams' first play, Orpheus Descending with Brando, who is still staggeringly the most dynamic and powerful actor I've ever seen on screen. You know, I could watch. I love that Brando said in these later years, I never walked through one role. I gave it 100%. definitely chose some funky movies, but I could watch Brando in his worst movie than a whole lot of people who would have called the first movie. So I'm watching the movies of Sidney Lumet, who I later worked with. I'm watching, you know, if you see, I'm watching, I'm always watching the movies of William Wyler. You know, that great documentary that came out 2 years ago, I'm jumping around here, that one that was nominated for an Oscar, Six Came Back, about six directors who were major, major glitz and glamour directors before World War II, George Stevens, John Huston, John Ford, Frank Capra, William Wyler, who go to war, and then they come back, and, you know, Hollywood says, hey, we got the next movie for you. And, you know, guys like George Stevens who went in and filmed Dachau, you know, and Wyler's Jewish and he's over there and he goes, no man, we're not doing Busby Berkeley, you know, or Song and Dance, man. So this is a product of Italy. This is a product of neorealism. Neorealism is realism. And that's the gift that, and I became obsessed with movies about my journey. I became obsessed about with movies about what is the personal dilemma? What's the dilemma with love? What's the dilemma with you know, finding your way? In spite of the fact that I still love Westerns because they were gothic on one side, you know, but my obsession with films with and then a movie comes out that changes everybody, a personal movie, The Graduate. Now The Graduate's a comedy, but The Graduate's also a tragedy. The Graduate comes right out of, Mike Nichols becomes a mentor to me. I do streamers with Mike Nichols. And Mike Nichols followed my career, God bless him, and I followed his career the rest of his life. And I stayed friends with him, and stayed friends with him, and I stayed friends with Sidney Lumet. So you take Sidney Lumet, I mean, the fortune that I had to want to go to New York and become a theater actor, which I did, and realize I didn't, when I got out of acting school, I knew enough that I didn't know, so I started studying with the great, great method teachers, Uta Hagen. And then became a member of the actor studio under Elia Kazan. Elia Kazan, giant, look at his films. You know, when I went growing up, I see Viva Zapata. That's a Western, but also that's like, that is a cathartic drama of politics. Because Kazan's facing the crowd, you know, man. A Kazan movie. There ain't many Kazan movies I can't watch over and over and over again. Panic in the Streets. Doesn't matter, but On the Waterfront. On the Waterfront, I see On the Waterfront when I'm 10, and it sears me. I can watch On the Waterfront, you know, forever. So those are the movies, those personal movies, those movies that come out of Russian theater and subsequently Italian film, whereby America in a postmodern generation start to make the personal arc rather than the melodramatic arc. Those are the films that got me, and I was very fortunate enough to study with Uta Hagen and become a member of the Actors Studio under Kazan. You know, it's not the dedicated Strasberg, but one came into the Actors Studio in those days, either under Strasberg or Kazan, and I was a Kazan guy. Kazan could take it down a scene in 10 minutes, man. I mean, 5 minutes, 30 seconds. These days, a ball of energy that absolutely knew what the spine of a scene was, what you wanted, needed, whether it was being fulfilled, what the physical life was, and just astounding. So that's what I came up with. Those were my heroes. I got to work with my heroes. Man, it's unfortunate for me that I did.
The most interesting man in the world. We'll be back right after this and everything old is new again with Peter Weller.
Now, back to America's entertainment pop culture talk show, Everything Old is New Again, with Douglas Viviani and David Cohen.
We are back here on Everything Old is New Again with Douglas Viviani and David Cohen. We're hosting, of course, Dr. Peter Weller, continuing our discussion about directing and what makes someone want to be a director.
So directing was always a product of looking at that. I think, like, okay, I know as a kid, I'm watching On the Waterfront and Avery St. Brenda walking along. And also it turns into this wide, like, 18-mil shot where they go sit on a swing. And she drops her glove, and he picks it up during the middle of the scene and puts it on his hand. And, you know, even when I first saw it, I'm thinking, like, did the director, did they just let that play on like that? Did Kazan just, like, was that orchestrated? Was that Brando? Was that whatever? Kazan says later on, Brando was, like, you know, a musician. You know, he was, like, a composer. So it definitely was Brando. So those are the films that got me. Directing was always part of it. I looked at John Sturges' Westerns. I looked at, like, Vista Vision, The Magnificent Seven. John Sturges always in these wide shots of, like, amazing backgrounds and stuff. The opening of Gunfight Joker Corral with Lee Van Cleef and those guys on horses coming right, camera left, coming through barbed wire, getting closer and closer and closer. Dmitri Tiomkin's score. That opening, I wanted to direct that. I wanted to be that guy who set that up. I want to be that guy who knew, like, a sunrise with four horsemen. How do you do that in those days, man? Just a vision in those big Mitchell cameras. Sunrise and, you know, four guys getting closer and closer and closer and closer until they're clip-clopping, you know, into town past Boot Hill. The vision of movies always just fascinating. Look, I just saw, we just taught Eclipse, which is the follow-up to L'Aventure with Alain Delon. You want to see some chemistry, guys? You want to see some chemistry? I don't care what your gender is in the world or whoever's listening to this. Look at Eclipse. Eclissa, that's Italian. And the theme of it is, which is resonant today, how an obsession, it's about the stock market guy, gets together with a modern woman. The opening is the end of a love affair. It is a 20-minute, probably four-line scene of two people who've spent the night talking it out, going nowhere, and the love affair ends. It's 20 minutes. And for the first eight, no one talks. Holy cow. You talk about directing. They're just like figuring out what to say next. And every adult has been to that one. And there's nothing to say. So the movie goes on, essentially reveals the obsession with materialism over personal feelings. That the stuff all of a sudden becomes, well, this is now Italy's coming back. It's making money. It's got no place to spend its money because the lira is not accepted outside of Italy. This is before Armani and Fiat and all that. Fiat's around, but they're not selling Fiat's internationally. And it's Alain Delon. Now, Alain Delon, A-L-A-I-N, people, if you don't know who he is, D-E-L-O-N, and Monica Vitti. If you think you've seen chemistry between an actor and an actress, or by the way, if you think you've seen good-looking people in the movies, and I'll grant you that maybe, Marilyn Monroe and Sophia Loren, everybody will run for the money. So does Paul Newman and Cary Grant. But there ain't nobody better looking than Alain Delon. And you look at Monica Vitti as maybe, and I'm not really, my preference, this is probably an offhand 50s thing to say, and if there's sexism in our prince follows us. There's a friend of mine, Martin Berg, who said Peter Weller wouldn't know a blonde if he was standing in a phone booth with her. And blondes are like, you know, I admire beauty of all sorts, including in men. The great thing about Southern Italy is you see the most beautiful women in the world. The bad news about Southern Italy is you see the guys who are just good looking. And, you know, white, Northern European, white guy, boring, middle class dude like me had no chance. Because you see these guys and you go like, oh, God, man. Really? He's got to look like that. He's got to look like, you know, he's naturally 4 hours in a gym with a square jaw and the great teeth and the hair. The hair is what I hate about those guys. The hair is just like everywhere, you know? It's like.
And they don't even have to comb it. It's all natural.
My brilliant friend, you know, Elena Ferrante's fantastic series on HBO. Read the books. See if this guy's in Naples. But my point is, you see Alain Delon, Monica Vitti in this film about materialism and about the attempt to find love in a materialistic world, a new materialism. And also materialism is also bringing us nuclear war, nuclear testing, and the Cuban Missile Crisis, and all sorts of things that are about to happen, that are happening then, frightening things. And you look at those two people trying to get together, and man, is that movie Eclipse astounding. And, you know, there's people talking about Africa. They meet their rich friend in Africa, this woman who is one of the post-colonial, you know, rich girls from Kenya, and talks about Kenya, the place. I mean, Antonio, this is not unintentional. Three women. And by the way, the women in Antonioni's films are the drive of the film in every one of his films, except maybe The Passenger. The women are the drive. I've never seen a male film director so pointed about revealing that the yin of energy is the more dynamic of the two. And Monica Vitti is a force of nature. And Alain Delon is a force of nature. But there's three women in the scene talk about Africa. One of them lives in Kenya, and she's wealthy. She talks about the space and the beauty and the context of Africa. But as soon as she starts talking about Africans, it's like the colonial, you know, there's 60 million of them and 3 million. There's only 60,000 of us. There's 3 million of them. You know, how are we going to hang on to it? It's the colonial white narrative still in the 60s about, which is France hanging on Algeria, you know, it's like, that colonialism is still prevalent, man. And it was prevalent with us. And we were in the middle of about to have the Vietnam War. That movie is poignant and penetrating. But those directors, I'm getting off on a tangent here. But those are the people that impressed me. Those are the people that made me want to direct. Those are the people like showed me how to direct. Man, there's a scene where Monica Vitti and Alain Delon get together in a cafe. It's claustrophobic. He doesn't shoot on sets. Maybe there's a couple of bedrooms, and they turn and twist and turn and twist. And Alain Delon goes to the cash register 3 times, ordering a sandwich, ordering a cold coffee, going back and forth. And she just stays at the bar watching him go back and forth. The staging is absolutely tremendous. Healy Kazan and Ewan Bothiodog said, what are you doing in the room before the guy comes in with a gun? What are you doing in that room? You're not standing around with your arms folded. But when you ever see that, Uda would say, when you see this, that means nothing's going on. Unless somebody's giving you a confrontation, like, where were you last night? But you see somebody with their arms folded, they got nothing going on, they got nothing, they don't know what to do with themselves. Or putting both their hands in their pockets. That's either like a choice. Hey, I want to hang out now. Like you see Alain Delon do it once in the cafe. Puts his hand in his pocket and goes, talk to me. Otherwise, they just don't know what to do with their hands. They don't know what the physical life is. They don't know what to do in the room. These are the things that absolutely penetrated me as an actor and as a director. And right now, Doug and David, I just finished acting again. I was in Guillermo del Toro's new Cabinet of Curiosities for Netflix.
Oh, really?
And yeah, and I did, I star in one of the episodes directed by the Panos Cosmatos, who's the son of a longtime friend and director of 2 movies I've been, George Cosmatos, both Leviathan and of Unknown Origin. And so, Panos, this is amazing stuff about it in 1979. Well, most of Guillermo's stuff has to do with ecology anyway. His themes are ecological. And Panos wrote this about 1979 at a fulcrum when America or the world is getting into air quality and water quality, really getting into it. And it's a beautiful piece called The Viewing. So I did that. I'm about to go do this movie in Thailand. Written by Peter Lenkoff, who's the guy who brought back Magnum, and Hawaii Five-O, called Valentine. So I'm acting again, and pardon me, on the directing note, the great Bob Thiel Sr., one of the great jazz producers, the guy who produced Coltrane, Glenn Scott Heron, had his own label, Flying Dutchman, very radical in a black upheaval. Not only that, the marginalized people of the 60s social revolution. Bob Thiel was mainstream in it, with Impulse Records. And he also wrote What a Wonderful World, this guy.
Oh, we got to take a break again. We'll be back right after this. When Everything Old is New Again, we'll continue with Dr. Peter Weller.
This is Everything Old is New Again, America's entertainment pop culture talk show with Douglas Viviani and David Cohen.
We're back here on Everything Old is New Again, talking to Dr. Peter Weller from RoboCop and Son of Anarchy and so much more. And we are talking about what you're doing and with whom next. What's on the agenda?
So his son, Bob Thiel Jr., is a blues writer for Warner Chappell, and Kurt Sutter, creator of Sons of Anarchy, and I are doing a documentary on Bob Thiel Sr., and we've got tons of interviews with a lot of people, and we're putting together the selling reel right now. Matador Films is producing a documentary. So I'm deeply involved in that thing right now. And I just got back from the the Renaissance Society of America, which is actually the World Renaissance Society in Dublin, gave me a paper on my favorite architect ever, a guy named Mauro Guiducci, first Renaissance architect in Venice, and maybe a genius, but Venice was very loath to ever celebrate anyone who was an architect. You know, you hear these guys, Brunelleschi's Dome, Alberti, the great architects of Florence. The Renaissance, Florence heralded its architects. Venice heralded nobody who built, because they did not want anybody of civic nature to get a reputation. And that's how Venice kept the lid on its republic. No cult of personality. Nobody can write an autobiography. Nobody can go, hey, I'm Douglas, I'm David. Let's talk about everything old is new again. No. You did your gig, you got paid a lot of money, and you went on your business, but you didn't go, hey, it's Peter Weller, everything old is new again. So Mark Arducci is my favorite architect. I just gave a paper on him. And then played golf in Italy for 2 weeks with a couple of buddies. So that's my life up to now.
Well, I'll take away from that a smidge of something here that sounds to me like, first, my comment would be directing sounds to me like you're in some ways painting a picture, frame by frame, if you will, and that goes right up your alley, I think, also with your love and interest in art. Am I wrong, or is that sound about what a summary of it is?
Doug, I got to tell you, when it's directing, right, it is astounding to me that you can meet directors of photography because you meet them in television and camera operators. And this is a remarkable camera operator, Bud Crimp, who I worked with on The Last Ship. And when one gets into Renaissance art, one of the great things about its painting is advocation of its painting is the rediscovery of single point perspective, right? Single point perspective is not what you're seeing. You're seeing all the time a three-dimensional experience with depth, you know, height and width. But to reduce that experience on a two-dimensional plane takes, to do it mathematically correctly, takes a vanishing point orthogonal, horizontal, and so forth, and knowing where the horizon is. And it's a science that essentially Rome had a great idea and how knew how to do it, but it comes back in the Renaissance, okay? So once that comes back in the Renaissance, people can frame wide shots in the Renaissance, or even faces, like take the Mona Lisa, with all of the disappearing hills and valleys and so forth behind. You can frame that such like a camera. But you'll see that the framing of it gives a shot depth. I cannot tell you how many cameramen don't know that. They would just shoot down. They'd put a camera on their shoulder and shoot somebody down. And I would have to say, don't shoot down. Shoot at or up so that I see this wall going backwards, so that I see this thing. These are supposedly experienced camera. I don't know whether they're not all technical school, but I tell you this, the guys I came up with who are not cameramen, I mean, Billy Friedkin is a great mentor to me. I never worked with Billy Friedkin, but Billy Friedkin of the French Connection and The Exorcist, a gifted, gifted guy as far as not only the drama of a film, but the vision of a film. I talked to him endlessly. I talked to Nichols. I talked to Sidney. Sidney the Knight was the guy who was talking about framing and lenses and wit with Oswald Morris, the runner of great DPs ever. And once I got in, you know, art is only, Renaissance art is only a function of film. It's all a function of, film is a function of art, wall art. And then I remember when I was doing my master's degree in Florence, the great curmudgeon, but an extraordinary Botticelli and Michelangelo scholar who ran this very elite graduate program in Syracuse that I'm giving an endowment to. By the way, I have 8 students or 6 students. They get to do the whole thing in Italy. We're looking at the Sassetti Chapel with all these frescoes that got the Medici in them and so forth. And so he says to us, we're there alone, he says, what's the point of this thing? And I said, he said, and he calls on me. And I said, well, look, in my mind, it's a movie. People coming in here to go, oh, wow, there's Lorenzo de Medici. And look, they're walking through the streets. And then, oh, they walk over here. And it's just a movie. And I remember one of my fellow students, they were very arrogant because I was like a made guy. They didn't think I was going to have the cred to be in their class with them because they were all art history undergrads. And one of the students turned, one of my fellow students turned and they went, "Oh, Peter." Just like bringing in movies. And Rab Adfield said, "No, he's right. Exactly right. It's entertainment. All entertainment. All art is entertainment. It doesn't matter whether it's a religious icon or whether it's a Roman fresco of Dionysus. If people go in to see it and go, yeah, there's like Moses with manna from the sky, you know, or there's John the Baptist walking through the Negev. It's entertainment. It's not just the icon that you're praying to. This is total entertainment." They wanted people to come into the Sassetti Chapel, you know, walk into that church and go, "I know all those people, you know, and what are they going to do next?" So I that was the first time I ever got validated that movies were nothing but, and Gary Radke, a great teacher at the head of the department at Syracuse, he said, it's all an organic evolution. All the stuff you see, all the way back to the caves of Velasco, the history of art, the story of art goes right into film. And I was very fortunate to give a webinar a couple of months ago on the parallels of modern film with Renaissance art. And you can see what great guys like, you know, look, Mike Nichols sent me to Arezzo to see Piero della Francesca. Mike was like very... he was not patient with anybody's imbecility or ignorance, man. And, you know, bring up a Bergman film. You know, we're seeing Cries and Whispers. I haven't seen it yet. Well, we're not going to talk about Bergman until you see Cries and Whispers. And so, well, we're not going to talk about art until you go to Arezzo, see Piero della Francesca. And that was Mike. He's a great student of it. But so is Scorsese. So is Billy Friedkin. So is Sidney. Those guys are like, those guys just love painting and art. And my friend, I brought up Bud Crump, because Bud Crump is a genius shooter. And we would talk about paintings all the time and framing. And he's a guy, he's a very good guy. I mean, friends with, he's one of the top operators to this day. Like, just astounding filmic camera operator. But a one-off, because there's so many in television that don't know.
Peter, I have to ask you, speaking of art, you know, we're talking to you over Zoom, and I can't help but notice this painting above your head in the background. Would you mind?
Have you ever seen this painting before?
I have.
Have we talked about that painting before?
We have not.
Okay, well,
I figured it was that. Time.
It's time. It's time. Let me get the thing here. Okay. That painting, I'll take my head out of it. That painting is the self-portrait of Miles Davis. I'm going to show you something here. Miles Davis was a very good painter. He's my one and only, he's definitely my most powerful artistic influence ever. There's my trumpet, by the way, lying there on the couch. I play the trumpet every day. This is a picture here of Miles in front of the painting.
I see.
And that is Miles's last, can you see that record right there?
Yes.
That's his last record, Miles in Paris, with that painting. Anyway, I was with Miles on his basically every gig he played for. Almost every gig you played for the last year and a half of his life. I tried to stay away from Miles because you never want to meet your heroes. Even though one of my heroes, and he's in this documentary, Ron Carter played bass with Miles forever, the maestro Ron Carter. And we're going to do an interview with Herbie Hancock and so forth. And Wayne Short is a friend. And I knew all these guys. And they always said, "Well, you got to go meet Miles." I said, "I don't want to meet Miles." And, Miles. So I was seeing Miles for the umpteenth time in Hermosa Beach. Magic Club, and the owner came and said, "Miles Davis is waiting for you backstage," and I went back, and I just, he met my mom, and he saw me in the Warrens, and finally I was with him in his birthday party, last birthday party at Central Park. He said, "How come you don't own one of my paintings?" As you can see, he paints like Kandinsky, he's a modernist, and amazing shapes, he drew all his left-painted painted many of the stuff he painted was in the last years of his life. And then I said, Miles, they're too expensive, and plus which the one I want is that one on the cover of Miles in Paris.
Holy smokes, time flies. We will be back next week to continue with Dr. Peter Weller of RoboCop, Star Trek, and more. Continue with a discussion of all things interesting, life, pop culture, and more. We'll be back. Everything old is new again. You've been listening to Everything Old is New Again, America's pop culture entertainment talk show. Find us on the web at everythingoldisnewagain.biz. That's .biz.
See you next week. Same bat time, same bat station.